reminiscing today and using the all-time, old-time goodies and all that stuff.
And to me, we have a culture surpassed by no other civilization, but we don't know anything about it.
I think you can always write something that the people will understand.
Thank God that he gave me the energy to carry out the role. I was just playing a part for humanity, and I'm still playing a part for humanity. That's my role.
Hello all, hello all. Thank you so much for joining us. Wherever you are, however you may be listening, this is Julian Butts, aka Distinguished Legacy, and this is another episode of Soundtrack My Life, Season 4, where we incorporate classic albums with classic conversations. Today, I've had the luxury of a special guest joining me today. She's a stellar educator, of course, a mentor, an advocate for youth and students and things of that nature. So also we're looking to get some thoughts on, you know, just life and music and everything else in between. So without further ado, Ms. Takari Belcher, how are you doing today, ma'am?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely, absolutely. it's something that was long overdue. When I thought about incorporating guests, you were one of the first people that I thought of, just because your energy. And I knew you were musically inclined, so it was just a matter of time, so I appreciate you. Absolutely, absolutely. So we're gonna go ahead and get into it. How many years are you into the education profession?
This will be year 7.
Really?
Yes,
7 years. So is it true, of course, my mother's retired, my dad's a year away. Is it true that it flies by, or is it like...
It does.
Really?
It definitely flies by, yes.
Do you remember your feelings first walking into a classroom in comparison?
I remember every feeling in every classroom.
Okay, what was it like? What was it like walking into the classroom as a first time knowing that it's yours?
Well, I've always worked with kids, started out in the church, mm-hmm. dance team, so I've always had that passion for, you know, teaching kids. And it became more than just teaching them. It became like instilling them with confidence,
right,
and showing them things that maybe they won't learn this in school, just being real with them,
right,
you know. So the feelings that I've had in the classroom have always been different. I always remember them because of the lives that I've impacted.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, so that's extremely important and necessary. I guess my second question for you would be, times are a lot different just from the 7 years ago in which you started, because I'm sure you couldn't imagine from the first day you walked in that you would ever experience something like what we've experienced with the pandemic and how that has shifted and shaped education, excuse me. And just to give people some insight, the start of the pandemic, I remember the school year not ending, right? And students being snatched out of school like maybe a month or so before school ended, right?
Right.
So you dealt with that, mm-hmm. to, you know, going into the next year, school being delayed and started late. And, you know, our different counties going by different mandates and not even really understanding how things were going to roll out. So I remember in your county specifically, y'all started with like teaching via Zoom.
Right, the virtual learning.
So how was that? How was the virtual learning process? Like, did y'all have lesson plans? Like.
It was, to be honest, for me, it was a lot because now I have to learn this new technology along with trying to teach the kids the material. So
right.
At first it was a lot, but as educators, can I cut some hair?
Do your thing.
We make shit happen.
There you go.
That's all I'm gonna say. So it was overwhelming at first, and then we found out different apps and mm-hmm. programs where the kids can work and be interactive, and we can see real time mm-hmm. things. So we were like, okay, this might be,
right,
you know, I like this.
Right.
I like the virtual learning. So to me, and then being on the tech side,
right,
of the world, I actually enjoyed it.
Right.
And the kids enjoyed it. They were engaged. But then at the same time, staring at a computer for 8 hours, mm-hmm. your mind is like, okay,
right,
I'm over it.
Right.
So I understand when the kids were just like, what?
Right. Right.
You know.
Absolutely.
But you find things to make it interesting. Like I said, I was always that teacher that I like to connect with my kids. So I'm going to keep them engaged,
right,
some way, somehow.
Right.
And I just keep it real with them.
Right.
You know, but Yeah, that pandemic was something else. We took a huge loss.
Absolutely.
In education.
Across the board. Yeah. Absolutely. What I admired about the way that you approached it, as somebody who was watching from afar, I felt like you kind of went out your way to make things like lighthearted, right? You didn't really take yourself too serious. I was watching your stories, and a lot of times I was laughing. I'm like, what is she doing?
Yes. Oh, yes.
And it was like, but it was necessary, because if you thought about your circumstances, if you really just leaned into what was really going on, it could have really like broke you down.
Yeah.
And you kind of rose in the scene, and that's why I thought it was important to kind of get you on, highlight you and celebrate you.
Well, thank you. As well as all
the other educators, just from, you know, dealing with this process, making sense out of it, and working through it.
One thing I've learned is that throughout life, I have to laugh at something. I have to make something funny, because it's too serious. Like, we lose people left and right, and I'm just like, I'm just that type of person. Like, I have to make life the situations that are going on.
Right.
And with me being by myself, I was like, I'm not falling into these.
Right.
Like, I gotta come out on top.
Right.
Some way, somehow.
Absolutely. And I believe you are actively doing that. And of course, as you all know, the conversation is one thing, but the music is an entirely different one. Her and I got a chance to speak on different albums that we may have had in common. And she had me going back into my archive, listening to things that I hadn't listened to and appreciating them totally different. Like Missy Elliott's Superfly. As well as digging back into albums like Kendrick Lamar, Good Kid, Bad City. We came across another one in common, of course, which is Ari Lennox, Shea Butter. So, as you think about that album, like, what comes to mind? Like,
just looking at my girl, you know, I love Ari. She is so authentic. She's real. She's raw. You know, soulful.
Yes.
So that's what I get from it. It's a very soulful vibe. To me, I'm like, that's my modern day Erykah Badu.
Right.
Listening to her music. And
right.
Stuff.
Okay.
And then, like, yeah.
Yeah.
So looking at the album, Eartha Kitt.
Yes. Yes, to me she just looks like naturally just like a star.
Yeah.
You know, where other artists have to be groomed and cultivated, it just looks effortlessly to her.
Yeah.
And if you could be so kind to pick up the vinyl and do the unwrappings and see what we may have to see what she may have to offer us. And of course, while she's doing that, just a little insight, Ari Lennox, also a Dreamville artist, which is a label that is, of course, consisted of a lot of great names like J.I.D., you know, J. Cole, Boz, so on and so forth. I mean, predominantly rappers, right? I'll hold on to it. Predominantly rappers. So for her to step forward and, you know, claim her name as an R&B artist is extremely dope. So when you think about some of the songs, and I hold on to that, when you think about some of the songs that, you know, you identify with for one reason or another, what would they be and why?
My first one would definitely be Up Late.
Okay.
I like Up Late.
Mm-hmm.
Cause it's like a self-care album,
mm-hmm.
getting yourself together, and you're just being honest about how you feel about somebody.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So I definitely relate with Up Late. Broke.
Mm-hmm.
I'm vibing with the beat on that one.
Yes.
Her and J.I.D., they came together and put together some lyrics on that one.
Right.
And I was just like, okay.
Right.
And what I got from that was like, we don't have to be rich to kick it. We don't have to be out here living this fabulous lifestyle.
For sure.
Like, let's just have a good night, just us together.
For sure.
Chilling.
For sure.
And the lyrics definitely, I was like, wow.
Yeah.
That's a strong connection. The lyrics made it seem like they had a strong connection.
Right, right.
In that one. With just being broke.
Yeah.
break me off definitely gives me my, that's what gave my Erykah Badu vibe.
Yeah. So, that seemed to be the woman's anthem on that.
That's my anthem. that's the
Right. But yeah. it's that balance, right? Like you said. I mean, sometimes it's that ratchet and righteous at the same time, and she provided that.
She did.
On one project, which makes it, you know, undoubtedly a classic project. For me, Ari Lennox, I just love her wordplay. To me, I feel like very witty. Like, I'm like, she had to write some raps at some point, because like her songs just gives me that vibe. For me, the introduction, Chicago Boy, is my number one, because I, like, once again, we were just talking about that, right? Like, let's see, it's very hard for a dude to approach a woman, right? So right. To see a woman in that position, like, let's see you talk your shit.
That's
and see how
and
right. And it was dope how she was putting it together.
Yeah.
And it was authentic. Chicago Boy and I think it's Static.
Okay.
Static was another one that I really liked, and Whipped Cream. Yeah. Whipped Cream was really dope. I just think it's really what she provides for me is an ulterior point of view from a woman. Like, how would a woman approach things if she was put in that position? I think about Jill Scott, My Name is Jill Scott, and some of the things that she did. I think about Floyd Tree's album, and Say Yes, and Janet. And it's always intriguing to me when women can step into that light and, you know what I mean, kind of, you know, show. When the tables are turned, like, what can you say? Pickup lines are hard.
Right.
So absolutely. So I appreciate that. So I guess on the outro, what song would you like to play to go out, and why?
I think I'll go with Break Me Off.
Break Me Off.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and we don't have to explain. I know. I think that's kind of self-explanatory. Let's see if we can find it.
Sleeping all day, cheating, rolling, 50 old gangs, about to lose it. The body's on fire. Love me long till you get tired. Ooh, baby, you got what I you's a real one, I'm inspired. Break me off. Ay, itchy, itchy, yeah, when the lights is out. I'm summertime, I should put that game.
Hew.